Good morning, all my dear students. Hope you are doing really good. Welcome back. Today we'll discuss a little more numericals on PPC and some MCQs based on the entire chapter. I just hope that the chapter gets over in this class. Next, most probably we'll be starting with statistics. Before jumping to that, let's take the questions first and try to conclude the chapter with these questions. If there is any query, please let me know. Okay, so yesterday we had touched this question actually. These possibilities were given to us of commodity X and Y, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, X is going ahead. We are increasing the production of X. And to increase the production of good X, we have to lose some other good because resources are fixed. So resources are moving from the production of Y to X only. So some units are lost every time in the production of Y. We were going from 10 to 9, then 9 to 7, then to 4, and then to 0. Let's take the first question. So show these production possibilities through PPF. What do the points on the curve indicate? So if they're asking us to show the production possibilities, it means we have to plot the PPC with numbers. So in this case we will take the numbers. So X, because it was given from 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, we took a scale of 1 unit here. And Y is given from 10 to 0, I suppose. So we took a scale of 2 units here, 10 to 0, yeah. Plotting the numbers, plotting the combinations, we get this PPC. 0 and 10 was plotted, and then 9 and 1 is this. 2 and 7, 3 and 4, and 4 and 0, all these points. Now the question is, what do the points on the curve indicate? We label the points as A, B, C, D, E. The points on the curve indicate that there is fuller utilization of resources. If economy is on the PPC on any point, it means all the resources are utilized fully, efficiently. Next question is, label a point F inside the curve. So we have labeled. What does this point indicate? You have to do this question in the register. What does this point indicate? It indicates that resources of the economy are underutilized. We have already done such concept. Next, label a point outside the curve. So we have labeled a point G outside the curve. What does this indicate? It indicates an unattainable combination. Economy cannot achieve it, because even when we are utilizing all our resources, the maximum boundary our country can achieve is this actually. Next, what must occur so that the economy can attain the level of production as indicated by G? What must occur? So this was the rightward shift of PPC. This is based on that concept. So you should be knowing a little about it. Economy can attain the level of production as indicated by G only when there is increase in resources. So we, our possibilities can increase up to here, and this could be a part of PPC. We could have a PPC like somewhere here, rightward shift we could have shown, or there is an improvement in technology, then we are able to produce more than before with respect to both the commodities. So this is that part. Moving on to the next question, an economy produces two commodities X and Y, its production possibilities are here. Calculate MRT. Now MRT will be in the form of ratio. Loss is to gain, and gain every time we have to take off one unit. So in denominator we will leave the answer always as one in denominator. Even if it is not given in form of one, we will calculate it in terms of one. So let us just see the question. We have in question 20, 14, 9, 5, 2 and 0 for X, and for Y we have 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. What is MRT? For first production gain we are losing 6 units, 20 to 14. Then we are going from 14 to 9, it means we are losing 5 units. Then we are going from 9 to 5, it means we are losing 4 units. Then we are going from 5 to 2, it means we are losing 3 units. Then we are going from 2 to 0, it means we are losing 2 units. If you observe the pattern, in this question, MRT is actually falling. But in all the previous questions we have done before, MRT is always rising. Because in reality, MRT is always rising. Let us, this, makes us move to the next question. Construct a PPC with the help of various possibilities. So all these possibilities, they have constructed the PPC. And the third part is comment on the shape of PPC along with reason. See, because in this case, MRT is falling every time. If you just test yourself, if you construct this PPC, you will get this shape actually, convex shape and not the concave shape. So PPC is here convex shape due to decreasing MRT. That is, less and less units of commodity are always sacrificed to gain an additional unit of other commodity. In the beginning, you were losing the most number of units, 6. See, this will not happen. If we will shift the resources from production of X to Y, initially we'll pick the best ones, you know, who can easily learn the production of Y also, so that we don't face much loss here also. Okay, then later gradually we will pick the ones who are not so much good in production of Y also, and then we'll get an increasing loss every time. Okay, but in this case the loss is decreasing, so this will not come as a question for when PPC can be convex, because I told you it is not there from the exam point of view. You have a concave PPC only, which is the actual PPC, but they have framed this question just for a better understanding of the concept, because when PPC, when MRT is decreasing, then PPC is falling but convex actually. Next, giving reason, comment on the shape of PPC curve based on the following schedule. Okay, this question can definitely come. Giving reason, comment on the shape of PPC. Commenting on the shape of PPC means you do not have to construct the PPC. You will not use the numbers on the axis X and Y, and you know, you will not plot the points here to check which shape this PPC has got. We will not draw it. We will just see the table and use some other way to find out the shape of this PPC. Now, what they have done is they have found MRT. 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, one good is rising, other good is falling. Initially, the fall is of 1 unit, so MRT 1. Next, 1 is to 1. Then the fall is of 2 units, so 2 is to 1. Gain is 1 because always. Then the fall is of 3 units, loss is of 3 units because we are going from 7 to 4, so 3 is to 1. And then the loss is of 4 units, 4 is to 1 because the gain is every time 1 unit. So this is the important line in the answer. As MRT is increasing, PPC will be downward sloping and concave to the origin. So we will have a downward sloping PPC, also concave. Sorry, this is not downward sloping and concave. We will have a downward sloping PPC and concave to the origin. You get the point. So what I mean to say is you do not have to draw the PPC and check. That's not what is asked in the question. If you'll draw, you'll lose the marks. You have to just, based on the table only, you have to you know, take out the shape of PPC, what is going to be, what this PPC is going to look like. So if MRT is increasing in your answer, then PPC will be concave shaped, something like this. Concave, I think this is correct. Yes, so something like this, PPC will be concave shaped in that case. Yeah, you will not plot numbers on the x-axis and y-axis to check the shape. Similar question, giving on a reason, comment on the shape of PPC. In this case, MRT, if you see now, I'm not going to give you MRT every time. In this case, MRT is constant. Every time we are losing 4 units, 16 to 12, 12 to 8, 8 to 4, 4 to 0. So every time MRT is same. In that case, since MRT is constant, constant means something is fixed, it is not changing, then PP curve, that is PPC, will be downward sloping straight line. It is downward sloping every time because one is increasing and the other good is falling. So that's the reason for downward sloping. And whether it will be a straight line, concave or convex, that will be determined by MRT. So here it is constant, so it is straight line. In the previous question, it was falling, so it was concave. In the previous question, it was rising, so it was concave. But downward sloping is there in both the cases because one is increasing and the other is falling. Negative relation. So These were some numericals based on PPC. I hope you're able to do them now. You will understand. Let us take some other questions. You can take this question. If the economy decides to produce 50 million tons of wheat we are taking here, and 50 is here, it is already labeled in the figure in the question, then how many tanks it can produce? So 50 wheat if we are producing, then there is no tank actually, because at point E the value of tanks is zero, the units of tanks is zero. Which point in the diagram represents underutilization? A point inside PPC. Unattainable combination, a point outside. And identify the point if resources are fully utilized, then you can identify any point above on PPC. You can write any point. Okay. Next question, let us take some MCQs. The law of scarcity does not apply to rich or developed countries, or it implies that consumers' wants will never be completely satisfied. It applies only to the less developed countries, or it implies that consumers' wants will be satisfied. No, it means consumers' wants will never be completely satisfied. Always demand will be more as compared to the supply of resources. If PPC for butter and guns is a straight line, it means always we are losing same units for an additional unit of gun. Which of these is not an assumption of PPC? Resources in the economy, there is no change. Resources are equally efficient in production of all the products. Because what is the correct assumption? That resources are not equally efficient actually. That is the, if we have to correct the statement, then the correct statement would be resources are not equally efficient. That we will write here. Okay. Next, in which situation PPC can be straight line when MRT is constant? Which of these economic problems deals with the technique of production? Which problem deals with technique of production? How to produce. Next, Ramesh is working at a salary of 35,000. He has two offers, 30 and 25,000. In this case, his opportunity cost will be next best alternative. Next best is 30,000. So opportunity cost will be 30,000. PPC is concave to origin because of increasing MRT. If it is a 1 mark question, you have to just write increasing marginal rate of transformation. If it is a 3 or 4 mark question, then you have to explain. An economy operates on PPC when there is optimum utilization. Optimum means most efficient, best utilization of resources. Then we will operate on PPC. Identify the central problem which deals with the with deciding the quantity of goods. So under what to produce, we decide what goods to produce, and after deciding what goods to produce, we decide how much quantity of those goods to be produced. So this is the answer. Scarcity refers to limitation of demand. Sorry, limitation of supply. Supply is limited in relation to demands. The word economics is most closely connected with the word scarcity. A point outside the PPC indicates unattainable combination. Opportunity cost is the cost of next best alternative foregone, which has which we have not availed. Which economic problem involves selection of category of people, that is for whom to produce? This is not there in the syllabus. Fundamental economic problem is limited wants. No, wants are unlimited and scarcity of resources. This is the answer. Which part of economic theory aims to determine income and employment level? Income and employment level, if you remember the difference between micro and macro, the alternate name of macroeconomics was actually income and employment theory, because the aim is to determine income and employment in the economy, and this income is actually national income. Okay, this is the shift part is not there. Then there are these questions, again repeated kind of questions. Labor intensive techniques are chosen in which country where we have labor surplus economy? Okay, a developing economy can be a capital surplus economy also. So this is not the correct answer. Any economy where there is more labor, we should use labor intensive techniques. Which of the following is related to microeconomics? Inflation is macro level subject, national income macro level, income from postal department. This is just one department in the economy. So this is micro. Then, which of the following is the cause of economic problem? All of these, not a central problem. We have three central problems: what, how, and for whom. So, not one is when. And which of the following illustrates a decrease in the unemployment? Okay, this you don't have to do. The problem of what to produce covers which issues. This all you can do now. This all we have done. I'll send you this PDF in the group. You can do your questions. You don't have to do the MCQs in the register. There is no need to do MCQs in the register. I actually don't have the latest edition, otherwise it has the latest questions, objective type questions. So that was all for PPC and chapter one. I hope the chapter is clear. There are no doubts. We covered a lot of topics in the entire chapter. We started with what is economics, and then majority of the topics were explained in detail. Like some of them were just not there in the syllabus. We had an introduction of what is economics and all. Then we talked about scarcity and as the root cause of studying economics, economic problems, meaning of economics, positive normative difference, micro macro difference. Then we talked about central problems, what, how, and for whom, opportunity cost, and PPC. So the weightage of the chapter for not for midterm, I'm saying for the final term is actually 4. The entire micro is of 40 marks, so the weightage for this chapter is 10%. But the chapter was important basically to give you the base for economics. So up to here till central problems, this was actually the entire base of the subject. All these economies in the world faces these central problems, the difference between micro and macro, what is positive and normative when we say these words, what is economics, and everything related to that. So the chapter was more of a base, so do not just consider studying it from the exam point of view. This is the crux of the entire subject, so it is important to understand. I think I can give you a brief introduction on statistics, which we are going to take in the next class. What statistics is, that's again the other book I told you in the first class. All those who have a spare register at their homes can work in the other register for statistics, but please do not worry about this at all. I'm just giving an option because we make two registers every year, one for micro and one for stats, and there will be a lot of practice and so many chapters coming up that both your registers will be finished. But the point here is, if you do have a spare register at home, please use it for making statistics register. But if you don't have, it is all right, no problem at all. You can use your micro register only to complete the notes in statistics. Also, we will start with the introduction. Again, the statistics chapter is also the first chapter in stats, also means introduction, also has the title introduction, the name of the first chapter in stats also. So we will introduce statistics now. And but please do not take this load of making another register for statistics if you don't have it at your homes. Do not text me, ma'am, we don't have, and can we use it at the micro register or something like that. And all those, please complete all your questions, all your numericals for chapter number one. Some unsolved numericals were also sent. I hope they are all done. So this was all about introduction to your microeconomics, or we can say just to economics. I hope everything is clear till now. The second chapter in micro will be taking later. Let's come to stats and have a little introduction of the second book also, what all it is going to be about, what statistics is, what is its importance, what is the meaning, how do we define it, what is the need of statistics in economics actually. Okay. So these are the contents in your statistics book. This is actually from NCERT, but we will be using Sandeep Garg for statistics also, as NCERT does not contain numericals to practice. There is just one sample solved for each type of question, and there are no questions to practice, and it is not enough actually. So we'll be using Sandeep Garg for statistics as well as for microeconomics. So this is how the chapters are divided into NCERT actually. Sandeep Garg divides the chapters into even subunits. Chapter 1 is all introduction to statistics, to economics and everything. Then the entire stats has got a science behind it. There is a certain procedure for finalizing the statistics for any information, whatever the purpose was of that investigation. And the entire science, the steps which it has got, it is, the first one is collection of data. We all collect the data first. We'll just take the chapter into such a good detail. You'll be making questionnaires regarding certain investigations. You'll be choosing your own purpose of investigation, maybe which soap is most popular in, you know, which in is most popular maybe in your area wherever you live in, or which mobile network is most used in your area. So you'll be preparing a question. We'll be learning all that in collection of data. You'll be collecting the data, we'll be asking people to form our, to fill our questionnaire and all those things. The next step in statistics is organization, that whatever information we have collected, we'll organize it into tables, and we'll make that frequency table, we'll make those tally marks and all the those things. That we'll divide the information on the basis of geographical locations. For example, this state has got this much literacy rate, this state has got that much literacy rate, and like that. So that comes under organizing things. Your organization also means classifying the data. So you'll put the data into different categories. Like whenever there is census, what is census? I hope you all know. If you don't know, please let me know. Just find and let me know in the comment section what is census. Okay. Then we have presentation of data. After organizing it into tables and all, then we present it finally in the form of bar diagrams, pie charts, graphs, frequency curves, timelines. We'll be learning all that. Next chapter is measures of central tendency, in which we'll be finding mean, median, mode using various methods of various series. Measures of dispersion would be really new for you all. A lot of measures of dispersion we'll be studying. That we'll be taking later only. Correlation index numbers. I told you that till chapter 5 we have in this term. Measures of central tendency. So let's just see what all the book has for us. That's the first chapter, introduction to statistics. Why economics? We have read it, and I have given you the brief in micro also. Why economics? Why are we studying it? There are certain terms which you all should be knowing. Please write these terms in your register wherever you are going to start the chapter. Who is called a consumer? Who is called a seller? Who is called all these people? When you buy goods, you may want to satisfy your own personal needs or those of your family or those of any other person to whom you want to make a gift. That time you are called a consumer. When we buy goods for our own satisfaction, see, when we buy sugar for maybe you know, as a household, as a family member, for consumption, maybe for putting it into tea or some making some halwa, making any dessert for that matter, then we are called a consumer. But if a sweet shop owner, if a sweet shop distributor, maybe if he is going to prepare sweets, then that person, if he's buying sugar, then that person would not be called a consumer, because he's still going to add that sugar into some production of sweets, and then the consumers will be finally buying it. So he's not buying it for consuming for its own purpose, but to prepare some other good. So that is why it is written in the bracket. You may want to satisfy your own personal needs or family's needs, or you are gifting it to somebody, then you are called a consumer. Next term is seller. When are you called a seller? When you sell goods to make a profit for yourself, you may be called a shopkeeper also. Then you are called a seller. Whenever we sell goods, very basic term. When you produce goods, you may be a farmer or a manufacturer. That time you are called a producer. Next term, service holder. Who are service holders? When we are in a job working for some other person, like you are an employee under some employer. You may be employed by somebody who pays you wages. Traditionally, we use the term wages, but now in modern times, we use the word salary. But if it is still used in traditional sense, like daily wages and all that, then we still refer to wages. So if you are paid by somebody for a job you're working for, then you're called a service holder. And then there is another term, service provider. When you provide some kind of service to others for a payment, like you're working independently, a doctor is working in his own clinic, that time the doctor is service provider. But if the same time the doctor is going to the hospital and treating patients and he's receiving salary from the owner of the hospital, that time the doctor would be called service holder. So these terms you should be knowing. You may be a lawyer in case of your service provider, doctor, or a taxi driver or transporter of goods. Like you are providing some service to others for a payment. That payment is not salary, that payment is your fees. Then you're called service provider. In all these cases, you will be called gainfully employed in an economic activity. So economic activities, please write this also. Economic activities are ones that are undertaken for a monetary gain. And this is what economists mean by the ordinary business of life. This is our ordinary business of life. List different activities of the members of your family. Would you call them economic activities? Let me know. Like, which activities, all those activities which you're going to list, are all these called economic activities? No. Do you consider yourself a consumer? If yes, then why? If no, then why not? So we cannot get something for nothing. Like this is the story of some Aladdin lamp discussed here, and we all have actually got it. Like we cannot, whenever he wanted expensive gifts, he bring it to the king. When asking for his daughter's hand, he got them at the bat of an eyelid. But all this does not happen in real life. In real life, we cannot be as lucky as him. The pocket money, just for take example, the pocket money you got to spend. If you had more of it, then you could have purchased almost all the things you wanted. But since your pocket money is limited, you have to choose only those things that you want the most. So this is the basic teaching of economics, the concept we also covered in microeconomics. Like we have to choose scarcity. Whenever there is scarcity, there will be choice. So scarcity and choice go together. So this is actually what is mentioned here also, that scarcity is the root of all economic problems. Had there been no scarcity, there would have been no economic problem, and you would not have studied economics either. In our daily life, see, these are the various forms of scarcity: long queues at railway booking counters, crowded buses, trains, shortage of essential commodities, rush to get a ticket to watch a new film, etc. These are all manifestations of scarcity. Why? Because the things that that satisfy our wants are limited in availability. You can always list more instances of scarcity. It is all around us. Then the resources which the producers have, they're also limited, and also they have alternate uses. This we have already done. For example, take the case of food that you eat every day. It satisfies your want of nourishment. Farmers employed in agriculture, they raise crops that produce your food. At any point of time, the resources in agriculture, like land, labor, water, fertilizer, all of them have alternate uses. Same resource, same land we can use for all of the purposes, production of non-food crops also, rubber, cotton, jute, etc. Labor also we could use for those purposes. So that is why alternate use of resources give rise to the problem of choice between different commodities that can be produced by those resources. I think by now all of you must have got this idea of your subject. If somebody asks you what economics is, now you know. Economics is actually deciding how to use our resources in the most efficient manner, how to, you know, and the most efficient manner would be which gives maximum satisfaction to the society, not just to one person, but to the entire society. Like, see, this is a nice activity. Identify your wants. How many of them you can fulfill? How many of them are already fulfilled? How many of them are unfulfilled? Why are you unable to fulfill them? What are the different kinds of scarcity that you face in your daily life? Then you will learn economics. And whatever you are going to do to attain all those wants, to have all those things or non-materialistic things which you wanted for yourself, then you are actually applying economics to it. So more than any subject, this is all our day-to-day activities where we apply economics, which people are not aware of. If you are able to manage your money well in family, it means you know economics. And then you'll be able to understand the concept even better. This again we covered in microeconomics, three vital processes of every economy: consumption, production and distribution. So we'll not be repeating it. Actually, the study of production we know, the study of consumption we know, how much goods the consumer needs to consume, how much goods the producer needs to produce for the market, and finally with among whom we all have to distribute it. That's the study of distribution. So that's all for today. We'll be taking actually the importance of statistics, the functions, what all stats goes through in the next class. Till then, just take care, revise the first chapter completely, learn the chapter, prepare yourself for this. Take care. God bless you all. Thank you so much.